I am sitting here with Donovan, his heart don't pump no Kool-Aid Sadiq. And this is the second hour, if you will, of Don't Believe the Hype, where we ask you to go beneath the surface of everything that you've been told and see if it's true for yourself, right? So don't believe the hype. What did your favorite president say? Trust but verify.
Trust but verify.
Right. So what is his favorite president, not mine?
Ronald Wilson Reagan, 666 himself.
The devil. So anyway, let's get right into it because I'm sure we're going to have a little bit of, you know, discussion here.
Absolutely.
And so, as you guys know by now, Nipsey Hussle, Aramaeus, that's his name, Aramaeus Ashkidom. I'm probably saying it all jacked up. I had it before I came on here. I'm a little tongue-tied. Anyway, Nipsey Hussle was murdered last Sunday, March 31st, at his store.
Niggas!
On his block, the Marathon is what it was called. So he was has a clothing store and among other things in this shopping center. And he was murdered by a guy named Eric Holder, not
the Attorney General?
Not the former attorney, because, you know, not the former Attorney General, but Eric Holder, 29-year-old guy that lived in the neighborhood. I guess he was also an aspiring rapper. Also a known informant slash snitch. He was in the store, and Nipsey asked him to leave. Guess he got his feelings hurt, came back, and murdered him, and then shot two other people
That's
in the process.
Damn shame.
Right. And so a lot of people didn't know exactly who... A lot of people didn't even know who he was at all.
Right, what Nipsey Hussle was about.
Some people never even heard of him. Because he's a West Coast rapper from South Central L.A. And so once the news broke, because we were actually doing a show Sunday when it happened.
Right.
So once the news broke, you know, a lot of people were like, well, who is he, this, that, and the other. A lot of people, like my daughter, she's gone to, I've seen him live a few times in concert. So, you know, her generation, they know who he was. But a lot of people think he was just a rapper. But as it's come out, now I knew about Nipsey Hussle because I heard about his ventures, the many things that he was doing. So I didn't necessarily know his music, but I knew him being an entrepreneur and the things
kinda,
he was trying to
kinda
do.
Kind of the Soulja Boy.
Yeah, but I would say way, way on a whole nother level.
Yeah.
And so some of the things, so he was 33, but I want to just also get this out the way, too. He was a part of the gangs, the Rolling 60s, the Crips organization in Los Angeles. Mm-hmm. Not sure if he was a
young pup.
And he was, he was 33.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. You know, he ain't with the OG. He's like a younger pup.
Right. Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, not with the Tookie Williams generation.
My generation, you know. You know, the real Crips and Bloods, you know.
So anyway, I'm not sure if he was still affiliated or not. It doesn't seem like he was, but, you know, in some of his music and stuff, he talked about it, whatever. Okay.
Right on.
So, he also had two children and was with, his girlfriend was Lauren London. They had a child together as well.
Lauren London, wait, didn't he have a child with, Lauren London have a child with?
Lil Wayne. Yeah, but this is who he was with.
These chicks
since 2013. They were together.
These chicks just be throwing it around.
Well, you know.
Keeping it in the same
that
circle.
That was her man, and they had a child.
It was my Afro Thunder Deluxe.
Okay, so they were together and they had a man, they had a child rather. All right, so now he has several ventures. He sold, I think he had like 13 mixtapes, if I'm not mistaken, and one of them he sold for $100 a piece. And he made $100,000 in one day. Said that Jay-Z brought 100 of them at $100 a piece and he sold out in one day to the tune of $100,000. As I said earlier, he owned the Marathon clothing store. It was considered a smart store where you can go on the app and buy these things and you can get music and a whole host of other things. In addition to owning the block, most of the block, he owned a Crenshaw and Slauson. He owned most of that block. A fish market and a barbershop. There's a whole host of other things in there. He did what we've been asking each other to do, was buy back the block. All right, so that's one of the things that he did. Let's see. He has a label called All Money In, which means the art of group economics. Keep all the money in-house, you know, and basically don't go, for lack of better words, tricking off the money, keep it home, right? Okay, and so it's actually a logo that he has, along with one of his labels. Now, he was in the process of purchasing a 6-story building that was going to house, if I understand, low-income residents in addition to a commercial area. So for maybe like one of the old school things where you had a commercial area on the bottom and then the, the residential stuff on the top.
Absolutely.
Now in there, let's see, it was supposed to be, like I said, a whole bunch of businesses and things. And he also had an organization called Vector 90, which was a STEM program, science, technology, engineering, and math. You hear that a lot, especially in California. There's a lot of STEM programs where they teach the children about the things that I just mentioned. And so in that, what he was trying to do was connect the hood to Silicon Valley and, you know, getting involved with the whole tech industry and teaching that to the children. Now, obviously, there's a whole host of testimonies from people that he had actually helped. He was just one of those people that he did the work. He's one of those people that did the work. What else is going on here? I mean, there's so many other things. And one of the things that I really liked in his song called, oh gosh, what's the name of that song? Hold on a second. I'm going to get it for you guys right here because I want to be clear on what it is I say. So give me 1 second. One second. Why Donovan is doing his thing. Okay, so the name of the song was called Dedication. It's with Kendrick Lamar. And he says this. He says, royalties, publishing, plus I own masters. I'll be damned if I slave for some white crackers. Okay. Mm. Now that was talking about his masters. He owned his own stuff. Mm-hmm. As I said earlier.
He put out mixtapes, of course.
Yeah, so he had his mixtapes, but he was big on owning his own stuff and doing for self. And so when I say that Nipsey was actually doing the work, he was doing the work. He put a lot of people to work. A lot of people in the neighborhood that couldn't get a job elsewhere due to the records and things like that. Mm-hmm. Again, he was big on education, fixing schools in the neighborhood. So
positive, brother.
Yeah, he actually stayed in the neighborhood. Mm-hmm. So he was doing the work. And so
kind of like me, I stayed in the neighborhood.
Right, well, kind of. So he was doing the work. Now, as I thought about this, I'm going to be honest with you guys. You know, as I thought about Nipsey Hussle and the things that he was trying to do, I actually got pretty emotional, which I'm a G, I don't really get emotional. And I was talking to my daughter, and I had tears in my eyes, because I was like, you know, this man was doing what we asked people to do.
Yeah, we want a break. Oh, yeah.
Right, well, we asked people, especially when I say people specifically, we asked celebrities to go, you know, get the money, come back and do the work, and then we kill them. Now, not us per se, but I'm just saying we in general, we kill them. Now, as I said, the guy killed him. Oh, because he's, I guess he's got his feelings hurt. Well, you know, he told him to leave, and so he comes back and he kills him.
Okay, well, can I put a spin on that real quick?
Yeah.
Here's what a lot of you women don't understand. You have these Ray Ray and J-Bone types out there, right? Then you got like a Nipsey Hussle, a guy that came from the same environment.
Mm-hmm.
It's just almost like the Civil War. You had the Southern guys, and you had the, you know, they were all Americans, right? We're all come from the same hood. And there's like a jealousy thing. So Nipsey Hussle, instead of sitting on his ass like we talked about in the last section, he said, I'm going to do something with myself. He started doing that. And then there's a form of jealousy that forms up because this guy's putting in the work. And these J-Bones and Pookies are the ones that don't put in the work. And they get jealous of that guy. And then they want to try to prove something. And that's what I think is prominent within the community.
Well, and I think that had something to do with it as well. Mm-hmm. I mean, because, like, if somebody says something you don't like.
Right.
So, I mean, we've had people say stuff to us we didn't like. The last thing we thought about was going to get a gun and killing them.
Right. But what I'm saying with these.
No, I get it. So, the point that I'm making is, yes, obviously that has something to do with it. Instead of maybe slashing his tire or something, I'm going to take him all the way out the game. Mm-hmm. And so, like I said, and when I thought about it, I really got teary-eyed because I'm like, you know, a lot of people knew him as a rapper, but to me, like I said, I wasn't a fan of the music because I didn't listen to him like that at all. But I guess in hindsight, I'm a fan of the possibilities. Like this dude was on, he was doing far above what a lot of people who are a lot older than who's been in a game with a lot more money was doing. He was doing the work, and that was snuffed out over a dispute. That, you know, just like the guy asked you to leave the store, so you murdered this guy, but you didn't just murder the man. But I should maybe digress a little bit because, as they say, you can murder the man, but his ideas will still be there. Mm-hmm. And so I think that's what happened. But imagine what else he was going to do had he still been here.
Well, again, the point of the matter is he did it the right way because you don't have to glorify yourself saying, look at what I'm doing. You know, he did it. The people that knew, you know what I mean? He kept a low profile. And, you know, that's the way you should do it. Because a lot of celebrities get involved in stuff. Have you noticed that your girl Oprah is now trying to, she took all her stuff down against Michael Jackson and stuff off her page because she has that thing. Anyway, that's a different story. But you see what I'm saying? They do stuff to glorify themselves.
Right. You know? Yeah.
And this guy kind of stayed behind the shadows and kind
of. Well, he didn't really stay behind the shadows much. He was 33, you know, and I think he probably, from what I've seen, he wanted people to see him doing the
right,
work.
Right, right. But what I'm saying, if you weren't in the neighborhood, you wouldn't know that this was the guy behind him.
Right. Well, a lot of people outside of California, you know, didn't really know a lot about him. But so, like I said, he was doing the work. So what do I mean by doing the work? Well, back in the day, W.E.B. Du Bois had this thing called the Talented 10, where he asked, you know, one in every 10 men or so to go acquire the knowledge and education, the skills and things like that, and come back and teach it to everybody else. And so that's what he was doing. He acquired the wealth, and instead of doing like a lot of people do, acquire the wealth and go move up into the hills and go do for themselves and live on an individual basis, this man never left. And he came back, and he was not only just like buying stuff, he was teaching people how to do that. And if you listen to a lot of his music, he was always talking about doing for self, you know, do this and that with the money, and never, you know, put this and that above this, you know. So he was doing the work.
Walking and talking.
We ask, like, we criticize celebrities, and I would say rightfully so, that get the bag, as they would say, and then go off and go, you know, like your Dr. Dre. I used to be a fan of Dr. Dre, but lately, within the last couple of years, especially when he gave, you know, the $70 million to USC, it's his money, he can do what he wants, but on the flip side of that, we hear about the HBCUs that are struggling because there's no money, but yet this Negro who got rich off the backs of black people go and give $70 million to a white institution, but then you hear, so we criticize those people, like I said, rightfully so. But then you have somebody like Nipsey who was doing the work. He stayed. I mean, he helped a lot. Like if you see some of the videos of people who are just grieving and just torn up, not because, you know, it was a rapper per se that was murdered, but it was a possibility that was good. Like this man, it's countless stories. My daughter said she was listening to the radio and people were calling in talking about all the stuff he did for them, just even on an individual basis, you know. So this was a good dude. Then, on the flip side, I have people, like, because I posted about it, people get in my inbox and say, oh, well, you know, he was a thug, he was this, that, and the other.
So what?
And I was like, you know what? Had we had that mentality with somebody like Malcolm X, then he wouldn't have been able to do the things he did if we had tied his past. I'm like, nobody has a perfect past. And, you know, then the fool also said, well, he was a bad parent because, I guess his daughter was there when he got murdered. But it's like,
did he anticipate being murdered? Yeah, and
so, I'm just speaking of the level of ignorance that's out there.
Absolutely.
And so I asked this dude, what are you doing for the black community other than tearing other people down and putting yourself on a fake ass soapbox of the stuff that you're doing? What are you doing?
Right.
You know, but so as I said, he was doing the work that he has been asked to do. And so we murdered him. Now, originally, they were talking about, oh, you know, it's a conspiracy, which it may be. Nobody really knows because we know that, especially like, go take it back to Marcus Garvey, the Agent 800 was the first FBI informant, black FBI informant, hired by the FBI with the sole purpose of infiltrating Marcus Garvey's organization, and he was successful. And so we know that J. Edgar Hoover, his thing was, especially with the black community, stop the rise of a black messiah because he didn't want... Him and the FBI didn't want a black messiah to inspire black unity. Well, they said to inspire black militancy. But we know that that was, let's keep these Negroes divided so that they don't get ahead in life. So we knew that's what it was about. And
well,
so,
the whole white supremacy is based on black people being at the bottom. Period.
Right.
Period.
Right. And so we keep hearing about the stopping the rise of the black messiah. But in almost every case, you think about it, in almost every case, the person that stopped the black messiah or the person who pulled the trigger was normally black. Now, yeah, they worked for the FBI, they were informants, but think about the person who's pulling the trigger.
The person behind that trigger.
Is the black person, whether they're getting some money to do it, whatever the case is, they are doing it. And so, like, that was partially why I cried, because it's like, we've been hearing this a lot. The stop of the rise of the black messiah, I hear about Fred Hampton, Marcus Garvey, Malcolm X, Martin Luther King, and various other peoples, but yet we're the ones that's aiding and stopping that. Mm-hmm. But then on the other hand, we'll say, well, we need black unity. We need group economics. These celebrities need to come back and do this, that, and the other. But it's like when they try to do it, we take them out. Mm-hmm. And it's like this, to me, it's the quintessential crab in a bucket mentality. And I don't know what this dude was really on. They say it was over some beef. He got asked to leave. But to me, it was more, it was much deeper than that. And so we kind of talked about this in the last segment of how people are raising their children. Because I have a daughter. I have nephews and I have nieces, and I couldn't imagine that there was something that I could have done or not done to raise them into being a monster and, enough to pull the trigger, right. All because, from what I see, that dude had no coping skills. He couldn't take his no or his rejection and go home. He had to take his rejection, go home, pick up a gun, and come murder somebody because he told him to leave.
Let me interject right there. Now, what are the chances that this young man was raised by a single mother?
Well, I mean, it's probably...
I mean, just what are the chances, you think?
Well, it's probably high.
Okay.
Now, but to contrast that, from mm-hmm. what I read, Nipsey was also raised by a
right.
single mom.
No, no, wait. I was raised by a widowed mother. Mm-hmm. And look how strong of a young man that I am. I'm not saying it's not possible, but what I'm saying is, if a man was involved in that young man's life. Women are more emotional.
Okay, but
So that's where I'm going with you with that.
I get it.
You know, he's letting his emotion, because a man isn't as, you know.
But, because I get what you're saying about the whole woman, and just, but at the same time.
No, I'm not blaming the woman.
No, I know you're not. Yeah. But what I'm saying is, because single moms do get a bad rap.
They do.
I know in his situation, his mom and dad weren't together, although he did go, you know, because he's actually people. From Ethiopian descent. So his father was in Ethiopia, wherever. And so he would go out there and learn that culture as well. Mm-hmm. So I don't know why they went together. They just weren't. All right. But
things don't work out.
A lot of times, the father is there.
Right.
And especially in a lot of those environments, the father's around, but father's a gangbanger too.
Right. Well, that's what I'm saying. Know? A father could be there, but that doesn't mean he's teaching the kid anything.
Right.
You know, so.
Right. So, I mean, some point in time, and this is kind of where I thought in my thought process, we have to start teaching our children coping skills. Mm-hmm. You know, everything, you can't have everything. Everything is not going to be nice to you, or everything is not going to stroke your feelings. Some things are going to hurt you. Some things are going to hurt your feelings, but you cannot pick up a gun and murder people.
We have to, number one, we have to start telling these women, stop dating your sons.
Well, again, because I get what you're saying, but I don't want to know. I don't know if I want to put the onus solely, because me and you have this discussion a lot. Mm-hmm. Where there's a single mama, there's also an absentee daddy.
But again, this is where we disagree. Absentee daddy or not, the mother is raising the child.
Right.
And she should raise the child to the best of her ability.
I got it, but you can't listen. I'm sorry. We're not going to put the blame solely, because listen, we know there's a lot of jacked up mamas out there. A lot of mamas got issues. Whatever, we're not going to dispute that.
Okay.
But I'm saying I can't be a single mama if the daddy is there.
Right.
But the daddy is not there. He's just as much to blame.
Because
I hear a lot from men that say, well, you know, she won't let me. And she's doing this. You know what? If you really wanted to be in your son's life, I'm not saying she's not a douchebag. Because she probably is. And trust me, I know women who do. I see it a lot on my timeline. Oh, you know, he think he going to get his son. I see it. So I'm not saying that does not happen. But at some point in time, if you really love your child, you do what you got to do to get in your child's life, whether you take her ass to the man.
Right.
So you can't keep saying, not you, but I'm just saying in general, that the mama is all to blame. The daddy is to blame as well.
But if the mother's a douchebag as well, and he's raised by, you know what I mean? We have a whole generation of young men now that are raised by a generation of ratchet women.
Right. But then I'm going to flip that around,
flip it
too. I don't want to play tit for tat. But there's always an opposite in of everything.
Mm-hmm.
The opposite is, okay, if she's a ratchet-ass woman, then if you are upstanding dude, stop laying down with these ratchet-ass women and putting seeds in these women to where it's going to create for you an 18-year-plus headache of dealing with a ratchet woman. Like, you got to start asking more questions. And so it's avoidable on both sides, but for whatever reason, the child is here. Whether you stay together, not you, you both still have a duty to that child. And so, to your other point, to concede it a little bit, if the mama is going to be there doing the job by herself, yes, She should be raising that child to be something other than a nuisance to society.
Thank you.
So I concede that point. Okay. But I guess what I'm really saying is, we as a whole, we got to start teaching our kids how to have coping skills. Like, I see it even, you know, no shade to nobody, even in my own family, mm-hmm. with a lot, especially a lot of the boys. Mm-hmm. I don't have any sons. I ain't talking about me. Mm-hmm. But I'm just saying, I see it a lot. These little boys, well, they're not the little boys to me.
Right.
But they don't have coping skills. We mm-hmm. want to, oh, no, it's okay. Yeah, right. Why do you do? They're like, no. Sometimes, and I'm not even saying physically, but we used to get it physically. Mm-hmm. You need to put a foot to his backside and tell him, show, not only just tell him, but show him, this is what men do.
Exactly.
If you got a son that's being coddled by mom, because by nature, that's just what we do. Mm-hmm. Women nurture, but if you're a man and you see that's to a fault, then you go get your son.
Exactly.
Because she is going to turn out a little boy, unfortunately, probably like the one that murdered Nipsey, one that don't have no coping to go, you hurt my feelings. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to go and I'm going to murder. Not only did he just shoot him, he shot him 6 times and then kicks him as he's dying. Goes back, yeah, so it's like there was more
to manhood, huh?
Right, but so somehow he got his people will say got in his feelings. Mm-hmm. How do you get in, like, where does that, that's learned behavior,
absolutely.
That if I can't get my way with you, I'ma take you out. And then he flees the scene, obviously, like, I'ma get away with this. I'ma go home and go to sleep and nobody gonna check me.
See, when the riots in LA happened in 92 and stuff like that, I beat a police officer and then waited for them to arrest me. Well, okay, I didn't do that, but that's what I would have done.
In your imagination.
That's what I would have done if the base command would have let us have gone down there.
Right. Yeah, so. But so we got to get to a point, especially in our community, where we're teaching our kids something they can use.
So let me ask you this real quick in regards to Nipsey Hussle. What do you think his legacy is going to be?
Well, there's a lot of celebrities, you know, like in Nick Cannon, where they had this conspiracy theory going around that he was murdered. And I'm not saying it's true, I'm not saying it's not true, I don't know.
Yeah, we don't know.
That he was murdered because he was doing a Dr. Sabi documentary. Dr. Sabi being a nutritionist, if he was. It wasn't really a doctor who taught people how to survive and have a better quality of life due to the alkaline diet.
Right.
A better way of eating. He had a village in, I forget where it was, I'm getting lying. But where people will go to be healed from things like cancer, AIDS, herpes, you name it. And so in 1985, he actually went up against the United States government in a trial. They tried to sue him for saying that he cured AIDS, and he proved that he did. Mm-hmm. And so from that point, you know, he became well known. I mean, as I always tell the story, like a lot of people have doubts about Dr. Shavy saying, oh, it doesn't work, this, that, and the other. But I'm going to tell you, I'm a witness. My mom, who is no longer here, when she was diagnosed for the second time with cancer, she was really bad off. We took her to Dr. Sabi's office in Los Angeles. They gave her a whole little meal plan, this, that, and the other. When she was following it, my mom's tumor shrank from 500 and something to 50. Yeah. My mom, when she first got diagnosed, could not walk, couldn't do anything. But when she started to follow the diet and take the supplements, my mom was on the go. I come home because she ended up having to move in with me. Mm-hmm. But I come home and she's gone. I'm like, where are you?
She's on the road.
She's doing her thing, but she was well. But then, unfortunately, and I'm not going to say it's because she went back to eating. Maybe it was just her time. But I saw her do with 360. So I'm a believer in Dr. Sabi.
Well, I'm going to be honest with you. I'm going to be honest with you. I do not believe on this earth that God would put us on this earth where there's not an antithesis for everything. Mm-hmm. There's always a counteracting to a counter. And the thing is, I believe the pharmaceuticals know this. And they don't want that information out because there's no money being made in treating people for their
ailments. I mean, it's like if you're a doctor and you tell me you give me the cure,
right.
Guess what? I'm not coming back.
Right.
And neither does your money. Mm-hmm. And so that's what the conspiracy was. And so they're saying that the U.S. government somehow had him taken out of here because he was putting people on. He was getting ready to
release
the documentary, give him the game. So now, to my other point, Nick Cannon said that he's going to finish the work. And so everybody else is being impressed upon to finish the work because Nipsey was big on group economics, helping the people in the neighborhood. Mm-hmm. His people was just something he always talked about, even a lot of his music. And so people should carry on the legacy You know, like, he was a young guy, 33. My daughter's 26. So that he spoke to that generation. Sure. Imagine how much power that music would have had with them if he was, not saying that it still won't, but even if he was here to carry that forward. Like, people in my daughter's generation need to hear that about group mm-hmm. economics, because they haven't really heard from our generation per se.
Right, right.
You know, they've seen us spending money and trying to keep up with the Joneses, because our mom's generation were on the front end of being able to live with white people.
Yeah, I mean, they, you know, I mean, you got to get me, it was a first time
right.
opportunity.
So they taught us about being materialistic.
Right.
And then we, you know, and have in turn taught our children. So here you have somebody like Nipsey Hussle who was saying, hey, we can do things ourselves, keep the money in-house, let's build, let's do this. I'm not only going to do it, I'm going to teach you. They say if you give a man a fish, he eats for a day. You teach him how to fish, he eats for a lifetime. Mm-hmm. And so he was embodying those things, which is highly important for, like I said, you know, our kids' generation. And a lot of us need to learn that. Mm-hmm. And so it is important that we continue on in that legacy. And it really is. And so, like I said, I weep because we ask these people to do the work. He does the work. Mm-hmm. And we take him out of here.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And not only that, I think about his woman, you know, Lauren London, and their children. It's like, golly. Like, look what you've done because you were mad because somebody told you to go home or to mm-hmm. get out of my shop. You take this man from every, I mean, it's just like, and then you hear people too, and I call them haters because I hate when people do this kind of stuff. Well, what about Ray Ray? Ray Ray is murdered. Listen, perhaps if we knew more about Ray Ray, and it's just the way it is. Mm-hmm. Nipsey had the public eye than a Ray Ray did, so it's hard to mourn for Ray Ray, but I think somebody like Nipsey was trying to say, to deliver the message. Yo, we don't need to do this. These are other. There's different ways of doing that so we can avoid other Ray Rays. Because in that same time frame, it was 26 other people who were shot
sure.
and murdered during the time that he was.
Sure, but let's relate this to what Cardi B is saying. She had to, you know, play the game. She had to do what she had to do to survive, you know.
Wouldn't
that argument work for the guy that shot Nipsey Hussle? You know, I'm just playing the game. I got to survive.
Well, I don't think any of it works. I don't think any of it. I think, listen, I'm on both sides of the fence with doing what you have to do.
Okay.
I believe you should do what you have to do as long as it doesn't harm others. Now, if you're doing what you got to do and it harms others, that's when you've crossed the line.
Gotcha.
You know, because I might need to do what I got to do and collect some cans.
Mm-hmm.
Or,
oh, no, I'm too good to do that.
Well,
we're at McDonald's? Oh, no, I can't do that either.
And this
we're at a warehouse? I can't do that either.
Well, listen, on the other side, of more of a seedy side, I might need to do what I got to do and go sleep with the landlord. Now, of course, I'm just saying if I want to mm-hmm. take it that route.
Sell drugs. I'd rather sell drugs.
Well,
to the community I live in.
If it's not harming anybody else, do what you got to do. But if you're selling drugs to the community, that's obviously
which
harming
harms
other
the
people.
Community. Mm-hmm.
So there's two ways of looking
sure.
at that. But to the other point, you know, Nipsey was going to meet with, I think, some form of the police the mm-hmm. day, the next day to talk about curbing gang violence.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, that didn't happen. So I think it's really a big tragedy because he was trying to, as some people will say, oh, he was a gangbanger. He was trying to right the wrong.
Right. A lot of entertainers have been speaking out in regards to Nipsey Hussle. Now, one person that I have a problem with is Snoop Dogg. Snoop Dogg came out and said, basically, this stuff has got to stop.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the problem that I have with Snoop Dogg is this. Number one, you were never a gangster. We all know that. Going to juvenile hall doesn't make you a gangster. I'm not trying to glorify that. But what I'm saying is, in the 90s, Snoop perpetrated where we're at today. A lot of the problem that's going on today, he
helped. I don't like to knock people because we all have a past.
Sure.
But on the flip side of that, Snoop Dogg is also doing the work too. I mean, he puts computers in the hood. I mean, he goes and gets back. He's not one of those people. Yeah, so Snoop, I get it. Because I think it's easy for us. It's like I was telling that asshole that was in my inbox the other day.
Mm.
It's easy for us who can hide behind
sure.
the confines of our home and not have people paparazzi and stuff and everybody digging into every aspect of our life.
Mm.
I think it's easy for us to point the finger at people.
Mm.
Oh, well, he used to do this. He used to do that. I'm like, well, gosh. what if we peel back the curtains of your house? What would we have known that you did that we don't know about?
But what I'm saying is, even me at a young age, I know that being in a gang was not a positive thing. No, wait, let me finish.
Go ahead.
It was not a positive thing.
Right.
You cannot tell me glorifying gangster life that Snoop did, he did not know what he was doing. There's no, I mean, come on. I mean, you just can't.
Okay, but the fact that he did that, is he now a worthless human being?
No. So that's
the point I think we're missing, because I said this earlier about Malcolm X. Malcolm X was all that. And then some. Yeah. He probably did, like you said, Snoop was perpetrating the fraud. I don't know if he wasn't. I don't have any
proof. Studio gangster.
So you're saying that he wasn't. So let's take to your point that Snoop is a studio gangster. Mm. Malcolm probably did more dirt than Snoop. I'm sure he probably did. Per what you're telling me about Snoop, if he was just perpetrating, Malcolm probably had more of a seedy past than he did. The pimping and the drugging and he probably did all of that. So if we discount people's past, or we keep them tied to the past, even though they've come away from that, when do we get to say, all right, there's no such thing as a perfect leader. Now I'm listening to what he's saying. Okay. He has changed.
Okay, no, nobody can change. No, I mean, everybody can change. Mm-hmm. Snoop's problem is, number one, he still perpetrates the marijuana life, which is hurting our community, which is okay. What you're saying is almost like saying, okay, I invented AIDS, and it got out. Look at all the people that have been killed, and all the destruction that's done to families, but I've changed, so don't
blame me. As I said before, I can't remember who I said this to. Mm-hmm. Nipsey nor Snoop invented the gangs. They are probably more than likely.
There's a guy named Coulter.
And you know, and to be honest, my dad was a part of a gang when he was young.
But the gangs back then was about fisting.
Right. He was part of what they called the Slaussons, which was in the area that Nipsey was in. He was a part of called the Slaussons back in the day.
Yeah, that was fisticuffs.
Right. So none of them invented the gangs.
Right.
That was already there. And
but whatever. The glorification doesn't help.
I'm not saying that it helps, but I don't hear them glorifying it now. And so, on one hand, and that's what I hate. We want to talk about all the bad stuff, but let's talk about the good stuff that Snoop is doing.
Okay.
All the good stuff that Nipsey is doing, because that's part of us. And I'm just saying you, but that's part of our mental, collectively, our mental psyche is to kind of be a crab. Well, you know, because that was a dude in my inbox. Well, he did this, he did that, he was a bad parent. It's like, how do you get to that and gloss over all the good things this dude was doing? How do you do that? So we got to get past the point of trying to tie, because I'm not saying I don't have a hell of a past, but there's some things I'm sure I've done that I wouldn't want people to know about it, but I'm not that person anymore. And so the fact that I'm trying to do good, we need to, I get it. This is who the person used to be. Mm-hmm. But what, talk about the stuff I'm doing now. Now, I don't think that, because I saw Snoop shed a tear over that.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
The game. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they were all in, you know, in the drug life, and they talk about the certain, not the drug life, the game life, and they still talk about it, but, you know, to hear them weep, they didn't sound like they were weeping because, necessarily just because that was their friend, they were weeping because this dude, as I said, was doing the work.
But you got, I understand what you're saying, but you're missing the point.
I hear what you're saying.
By the fact that he did what he did, this is where we're at today.
Snoop and Nipsey are not the creators. They are
No, they're not. But the point is, creator or not, when you glorify it, you...
Wait. Go ahead.
When you glorify and you make your thing being a studio gangster, whatever you're doing, you're saying, oh yeah, do this, and hoes, and G's up, whatever. This is a manifestation of what
continues. No, it's not.
Yes, it is.
That Snoop... And what he's doing did not make that man pull the trigger.
No, that ain't what I'm saying. That lifestyle that he glorified is a manifestation of what he continued in the 90s. I'm not saying he's doing it now.
A manifestation of what, though? I guess maybe that's why I'm confused.
The manifestation of the gang life in this culture where the kids think that this is all cool and acceptable. We're all complicit in it. All of us are complicit in it.
Okay, so what's your point?
My point is, he can't be sitting up here... talk about it, you know, don't get me wrong, he can say, yeah, it needs to stop, but at the same time, he was a big part of it.
Right. There's a saying that goes, when you know better, you do better.
Okay.
There's a lot of people to this day that have done some pretty grimy things and they don't do them anymore. Mm-hmm. That's what you call evolution. Okay. You grow when you learn how to do things better. You don't operate as it says in people who follow the Bible. When I was a child, I did what?
Right.
I acted as a child, but when I became a man, I put those childish things away. That is life in general. When I learn better and how to operate on a higher level, I don't do those things anymore.
Okay, where is Snoop out there saying gang violence needs to stop? Where is he saying that?
Snoop says that a lot.
He says it a lot, but what foundation does he have set up to stop that? And I'm sure he does have them. I'm just saying, how can we don't know about these things?
You don't know about them. Okay. But the people who he serves, see, and that's the other thing, too. A lot of times we get it wrong and thinking, because I don't know about it, it must not be true.
No, I didn't say that.
But I'm just piggybacking off of your point. So maybe the people that needs to know about them, those are the people who are being served, like the neighborhoods. Like you live, you don't live per se in the neighborhood. If I live in
Beverly Hills. I keep it real. Go ahead.
If I live in Beverly Hills, I'm probably not having no gang problems. Okay. So the people that he's serving know about those things. Just like with Nipsey Hussle. A lot of people didn't know outside of South Central Los Angeles didn't really know about his philanthropy until he died. But there's countless of stories of people said, hey, he helped me. So just because we don't know about it, and that's a lot of times too, especially Bible thumping Christians. I'm not saying that you're one, because I know you're a heathen and you're not. But it tells you, especially, and listen, I don't go to church, but I know a lot about the Bible and just the laws of the universe. But it says when you're helping people, it doesn't always need to be done to the glorification of you and say, hey, look what I'm doing. When you're helping people, a lot of times it's done in secret. Mm-hmm. So that those people benefit from it, and the glory is not taken off of, not necessarily them, but it's not put on you like, hey, look what I'm doing. It's to actually serve a purpose.
Right. Now, let me give a disclaimer. The reason I did that, because you always play devil advocate on my show. I'm playing devil advocate.
I eat your lunch, boo. I eat your lunch.
No,
even as a vegan, if you're eating steak, I'm going to eat it.
Yes, and because I know whenever we put the video up, we're going to have people that are going to, say
what I'm saying. Well, yeah, I mean, I've had people come into my box and do it. I mean, and I was just saying, basically, to put up a video of the good things that he done, and people came in, he was this and this that. Out to the point, like, I don't know Nipsey, never did I know him. My brother knew him. Mm-hmm. So I didn't know him or nothing like that, but I wanted to delete this dude, not only because he was talking bad about Nipsey, but the fact that your ideology and your views of life is so effed up. I don't want to even know, I don't want to even have a conversation with somebody like you because you think, because your life is perfect from what you tell us, that you get to shit on other people.
Right, and the reason why I brought Snoop up, because there's going to be a lot of people that are going to say the same thing that I just said. Hey, he glorified this, this is a manifestation of what happened and whatever it is. And you're right, I agree with you 100%. That doesn't mean he can't change.
Yeah, people change all the time.
And just because we haven't heard of any Snoop's things, I know for a fact Snoop does a lot in the community. I know that for a fact. I'm just bringing it out because you're going to have these people out there in YouTube world. You live in Massachusetts. You don't know what Snoop does out here. Snoop has one of the most successful youth sports programs in California, where a lot of students
go out there and work.
Exactly.
He does the work.
Thank you.
And somebody like Nipsey was doing the work. And so oftentimes, like I always ask people that when they want to talk about people's leaderships, people in a leadership role who did this and did that. I ask people, do you want your leaders perfect? Do you want your leaders? I don't.
I do.
I don't want my leaders perfect because I want you to be able to be honest. It's like the same thing when we elect politicians. Oh, I'm going to help you out down there in the neighborhood. I'm like, how? When you ain't never lived and been in on that, you don't know my struggle. So I want somebody who is closer to my struggle because I know they understand. I know I don't have a person over me telling me what to do and you ain't never been. Mm-hmm. Like Donald Trump has probably never eaten at a hot free lunch at school.
No.
Which is why it's easy for him to say, well, we need to cut that program. Mm-hmm. You can't, you don't know what it's like for many kids that go to school and that's their only two good meals they're going to have, but yet you're talking about taking it away.
Or your girl Nancy DeVos wants to cut the special
Olympics. Why are you doing that?
Yeah.
And
now she's trying to backtrack like, oh, well, I'm glad the president.
But where does she come from? What is her background? She's a wealthy woman. Mm-hmm. But yet here you are telling poor people and disadvantaged people and marginalized people what they don't need.
Exactly.
When you've never had to not need those things. And so when I say that about our leaders, I want my leaders to have a little dirt on them. I want them to be able to say, I've been
You
there.
Can relate.
Yes.
You can relate to them.
So that's why I ask when we demonize people who we deem to be leaders, Do you want them to be perfect without blemish, first of all? And are you those same things?
Right, but you will agree we should hold them to a higher standard.
Yes, it should be held to a higher. I'm like, okay, listen, I don't want my leader out there. Let's use Malcolm X, for example. I didn't, you know, he used to be a pimp and doing mm-hmm. selling drugs, whatever, came burglarizing. Mm-hmm. I don't want him being Malcolm X still doing those things. So, yes, mm-hmm. he should be held to a higher standard, but I can't hold you to a higher standard if I'm not also striving to be held to a higher standard. Yeah. Like, you know, I work with people in politics. People want to run for office. Mm-hmm. And I say to them, one of the first things I ask them,
is there anything
that we should know about you that will come out? I don't care what it is. You kick the cat and somebody see whatever it is. And so that's what we should be thinking.
I used to be a Catholic priest.
Yeah. Is there anything we need to know about you that you wouldn't want people to know or that may get out? And so when I say that, it's the same thing for a leader. Mm-hmm. And obviously most leaders are going to say, yeah, back in the day I had a whoopty, this, that, and the other. So but those are things that are going to come out. Just don't still be doing those things.
You know, but let me ask you this as you brought that up. Have you ever had a client that didn't tell you everything?
Yes.
As the October surprise on
yes.
you?
Yes. Oh, wow. But I didn't take that personally. Yeah. Just because it's one of the first things when I sit down with somebody, why are you running or whatever is they're doing? Okay, this, that, and the other. All right, the next line of conversation, is there anything else we need to know about you that will come out? Not could, because especially if you're in the running, like you have, look at Joe Biden, for example.
Yeah.
You didn't hear about none of this stuff when he was running as VP with Obama. Mm-hmm. You didn't hear about none of that stuff, but now he been kissing up all the women and touching mm-hmm. up all the kids, all but it's, to which I think is bullshit. Mm-hmm. I really do.
Kamala Harris. No, nobody realized that she was a side chick and she learned at the fraternity and all that other good stuff like that. You know what I mean?
Is there anything we should? So that's what I'm saying. When we come to our leaders, there's gonna be something that we know about you. I don't have a problem with a person having a past, depending on what that past is. Now, obviously, want to be silly, but I don't have a problem with you having a past as long as that reformed. You're reformed and you no longer do those things. Like, that stuff don't turn me off.
Right.
Unless they have to do something with you, you know, raping and doing stuff. That, okay, we might want to, you probably don't do those things anymore, but we probably don't want you running the daycare.
So a good example is the ladies asking the man how many times he's been married, how many children he has. You don't want the guy to be like, you know,
it's,
kids coming out.
Well, when you're dating somebody, it's called the courting process.
Yes, right.
And I'm speaking from experience. I haven't always been one of those ones that ask a whole laundry list of questions that I will deem important if we're going to stay together. You know, it's called ask questions. But I don't want my leaders necessarily to be without spot or blemish because I want them to be able to relate. So when we talk about somebody like Nipsey and Snoop, were they perfect? No, but they were doing the work. So, like I said, we got a lot of people like in Dr. Dre's who I personally think is a douchebag. It's just my personal opinion. Don't come for me because I will come back. Mm-hmm. I think this thing is a douchebag. He took all the money from the hood, came up. Yeah, all his money is not from the hood, but he
all
got
the
to
support
start.
Came from the
hood. Yeah, they're like white folks wasn't listening to niggas with attitudes. Mm-hmm. And now you go and give all your, you know, a good amount of money to white schools. I mean,
he's trying to get his daughter into USC.
Well, yeah, which she happened to get into.
Right.
But I mean, so
you know, you see how the game works.
Yeah, so we have people who are doing the work and we're taking them out. It almost gives credence to the people like you, Dr. Dre's, who leave the hood. Like, well, I'm going to stay and get murked for. You know, I'm going to stay and do the work and you're going to kill me. So we need to fix that. Is it illness, a sickness in our community?
Well, you know, I agree with you. The thing is, we don't have to leave the hood. We can gentrify our own hood. Just because you
which is what he was trying to do.
Right,
Nipsey
right.
was trying to do
clean,
those things.
And teach your kids to pick up the trash. The simple thing is just having a clean neighborhood makes such a difference.
Yeah, so it's a loss, and it really is a loss. We need to fix ourselves. We are not well. We need to heal those things. We need to teach our kids some coping skills.
Absolutely. Especially our young boys.
Especially our young boys. And like I said, I see it all
because
the time.
Because we don't have coping skills. That's why they're getting shot in the streets. One of the reasons.
Oh, and why they shooting people. Mm-hmm. You know, like, and then I know we got a couple seconds, you know, you hear about it all the time where a woman was murdered or beat up because she told a man no.
Yeah. Yeah.
Teach your sons it's okay to hear the word no. Mm-hmm. Go on to the next one that's going to tell you yes.
Right. But if your mother is a stripper and that's
your daddy ain't there.
Right. Right. I mean, that, you know, this is what gets passed down, and
right.
it's unfortunate. But then again, as a community, we need to step up. Like the old days, Miss Johnson saw you do something wrong, she calling your mama, and she going to whip that ass.
She called your mama after she whipped your ass.
Right, after she whipped your ass. So, again, you guys, this has been Don't Believe the Hype, kind of hot heated, but that's what we do here.
All right,
see
now.
See you next week.
Peace.
Listen and understand. That Terminator is out there. It can't be bargained with. It can't be reasoned with. It doesn't feel pity or remorse or fear. And it absolutely will not stop. Ever. Until you are dead.